Says God has accepted us in the beloved. I don't know about your past life, but if I look at the panoramic view of my life story, I can't see any place where God should have just accepted me just based on what I did or who I was. But for some reason, God bestowed his love upon us in such great fashion. He sent a Savior to die for us named Jesus Christ. And it's Jesus accepts us not because of who we are, but in spite of who we are. Do I have a witness in the house? Amen. And on this Mother's Day, as we honor mothers, the ones who worked and labored and toiled on behalf of your children, some who may not be really thankful for all you've done, you still love your children and accept them in spite of who they are. I think the mother's love for a child is one that is so representative of God's love for us, and that your baby could be a mass murderer, God forbid, that's still my baby. And there's something that cries out for mercy for your child, even though you know You've seen the news reel, right? You've seen the 5 o'clock news where so-and-so goes to jail, but the mother's like, but it's my son or my daughter. And that's an extreme case. I know nobody here has an extreme life like that. No, not at all, right? Nobody? Let me know. But when you think about the things you've got into, in spite of, I think, Pastor Devon or Minister Melvin mentioned last week about the extension of grace. I pulled the plug out myself and deserved for things to be turned around on me and turned off on me. But God still loves us yet. I want to just take time to celebrate all the mothers who love in spite of in the house. Can we give the mothers a hand who love in spite of? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Come on, give them glory. Now they can. They brought us into this world and they can suddenly take us out, right? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Lord, for the mothers. How many folks have a mother who loved you so much she wouldn't knock you in the middle of next week? And go back there and pull you back in today. And that's love, y'all. That's love. That's some strange, dysfunctional love, but it's love. Praise God. We honor you. Thank you. Who's all? Just wave your hand if you're a mother visiting in the house. Praise God. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. Thank you. Thank you for coming out. Now, I know your kids dragged you kicking and screaming to church today, like you used to drag them kicking and screaming to church, and yeah, payback is something else, isn't it? Praise God. But we honor you. We thank God for your presence. We want to bless you today, and we want to be a blessing to you. So they have some wonderful treats for you after service. But I'm going to get in the Word. I'm going to just pray real quick and ask that God blesses this time so that the Word can minister to our hearts. Father, we thank you and praise you. Everyone in this house, Lord God, is a recipient of your grace, and we're in this place only because of your grace and mercy. And it wasn't because we were so great or so popular, so cute or beautiful or smart, because you just sought to love us because you love us. And you've given us mercy and grace that continues on to this day. God, we declare today that we are yours and you are ours. And help us, Lord God, to reflect this supernatural love that you have for us to others in Jesus' name. As we continue to build community, as we continue to develop relationships in God, we thank you and praise you that you'll give us grace to continue on. And we ask that you anoint the words that you speak to your people, that their lives may be impacted in a powerful way today. In Jesus Christ's name, we come against every demonic force that would try to interfere with the work that the Spirit is doing. And we thank you, Lord God, we'll release people to have Mother's Day brunch and times of refreshing with family. In Jesus Christ's name, we say amen. Amen. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's a great day. Hallelujah. Let me ask you a question. Technical folks, do y'all put the podium way back here on purpose? I can push it forward. All right. Just checking, because. All right. So, today is Mother's Day. And how many folks were here last week? Okay, praise God. You guys caught Pastor Dre's second installment of R3 equals 1. Remember R stand for? Restitution, repo man. No, not the repo man. R3 stands for resolving, restoring, and reconciling. And we talked about relationships. We've been talking about relationships for the last few weeks because we have lots of new folks in the church. And how about this? Some of the folks are new to Christ and new to church things. Amen? So it behooves us to learn how to work, operate, live, flow, and flourish together as believers in this particular place that God has blessed us in. And I know that many of us are believers in Jesus Christ, but even with the fact that you believe in Jesus Christ, been washed in the blood, been sanctified and set apart, you still have some issues to work on, don't you? Maybe it's just me, okay? Me and my wife have some issues to work on because she amazingly brought that out last week at service. I wasn't here to defend myself, but I heard that she said some things about a brother and I wasn't here to defend. I'm glad I wasn't here because it would have been pandemonium in this place. So I want to set the record straight. She was right. I'm smart. I've been married 27 years for a reason. I know how to back up. No, she was right and I was wrong. But there's always a but. At the time of the conflict in the Humphrey household, I was in my heart displaying defiance, even though with her words she was expressing her sentiment. And I was unaware of the fact, as she shared her feelings about, for those who don't know, there was a situation where I was going to throw something away that belonged to my daughter, which I deemed as unimportant or junk or trash, as kids can accumulate junk and trash. And I'm not a neat freak, but I just like things neat. I like things uncluttered. And I said, this is junk. And she said, hey, what are you doing? And I said, I'm gonna throw it away. She said, the gall of you going to throw stuff away. It's not even yours, and you didn't even ask. I'm like, and? No, I didn't say that. I've been married 27 years, so I know when to bite my tongue. So she was giving me her version of why it was wrong, to which, in retrospect, I concur, but at the time, I gave the appearance as if I really cared about what she said. Oh, it's just me? Y'all, brothers, you know, you just want her to, are you finished yet? Are you through? I want to watch the game. But you know not to say anything, right? And so I didn't realize that she left and kept on talking to herself, as she mentioned. And I was still in my defiance, like, I pay good money, I buy stuff, I go to work every day, I would just, you know, that mental conversation that I would never, ever share with, the conversation I would never share with her. And so, interesting enough, you know, a little conflict, but it shows we're real people. And we have issues and challenges. And one of the things about the body of Christ is that we all come from different places and backgrounds and different mindsets and different worldviews and different, and one of the things she said, we have different agendas. One of my underlying agendas is I don't like junk and clutter. That's just my agenda. How many folks got me on that one? Just okay, praise the Lord. All right, we're gonna have a special meeting after service, so we're going. The uncluttered group. Y'all got unstuck, we getting uncluttered, okay? That's a men's conference, uncluttered. Okay, anyway, to be serious and back in the spirit. So we had a little confrontation, and yes, she was right. And funny thing, so I left the object on the countertop that day. I meant to ask my daughter, do you really want this or value this? Because I don't want to throw it away. 6 days go by, and it's still there. I'm like, I should ask her if she, I didn't want to throw it away without asking her, even though the statute of limitations had, in my mind, passed. Because the daughter didn't come back to claim it or express any interest in it. So I'm thinking, it must be trash, because I was right, right? I was right, cousin, I was right, really. And so I went to ask her, and she was watching videos. I said, you want this little thing? And she said, that thing? Nah. I'm like, I was right! But I was wrong. I was correct. Yeah, because I should have given my daughter respect and asked her if she wanted her stuff. Whew. Okay, we good? That was last week. This is my week, okay? So, all right. But thank you, wife, for throwing me under the proverbial bus. For the purpose of the glory of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just take me, Jesus. Hallelujah. Okay. But I want to continue on in that vein. I'm not going to tell stories about her. I'm actually telling you another story about me, because I realize I have some issues. And my issues may interfere with our fellowship from time to time, won't they? And if you're smart and understand who you are, you recognize sometimes your issues will interfere with our fellowship. So God has called us to be one, have this fellowship, have this amazing relationship one with another. And I'm not going to talk about me. This is about us. What about y'all? As we develop relationships, it's critical that we learn to operate together in a manner that brings glory to God and unifies the church as opposed to divide the church. And so the Bible tells us there's a couple of different ways we can respond to each other. One way does not help fellowship. One way enhances fellowship. And if you need a Bible, our ushers have Bibles in the audience. You can raise your hand, get a Bible, and study along with us. I'm going to go through a couple of scriptures. But we can either respond and deal with people in a way that gets fleshly results or respond and deal with people that gets godly results. How many folks prefer godly results? Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. So, I want to give you a passage called Proverbs 15:1. Proverbs 15:1, a very simple passage. that you probably know already, but it says this: a soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Amen. You guys heard that before. Have you experienced that? On both sides, right? A soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. A very similar scripture, Proverbs 25:11, says, a word fitly spoken is like apples of gold in settings of silver. I imagine on someone's mantelpiece or someone's table setting, apples of gold in settings of silver. It's something ornate, something beautiful, something decorative. And great words, or words that are fitly spoken, decorate and enhance the household and enhance this house. Amen? So we want to make sure we have the right kind of response, because in our relationships, we'll always have a choice, the blue pill or the red pill, won't we? Right? And sometimes we choose wrong. So the question I want to ask today for you, is your response fit for a king? Today's title, is your response fit for a king? So often in relationships, we start off with a great blaze of excitement and a great level of engagement in the other person, and sensitivity and love, and in fact, you know, you ever been booed up? Who's been booed up before? And when you booed up, your language pattern changes, doesn't it? You call them pookie poo and honey bun and booski and munch a brunch a crunch and all this stuff, you know, all these type of things, all these pet names, and that's my boo, that's my you know, that's my ride or die, you know, and all these different terms that I was looking at. I'm gonna put my brother Jamel Farley on blast, because he got married a year ago and they celebrated, and I saw his wife put a Facebook post, and since it's public, I can tell y'all, but she's like, it's public. It was shared with more people than in this room, okay? And but it's like, you know, happy anniversary to my honey bunch. I'm like, gag me. And I said, they just been married 1 year. Because what I know from pastoring and living for 20-some years in marriage, I know that sometimes our speech deteriorates over time, doesn't it? The quality of our affirmations and the frequency of our encouragement deteriorates over time, because let's say you start off with all the honey bunch and all the Captain Crunch and sugar smack. You my sugar smack girl, can't get nothing super sugar crisp girl, you know, sugar bear. I mean, all that stuff, right? But something happens over time. And there's an example I want to share. Sometimes when you are dating or courting and you're all enamored and everything they do is cute, everything they do is beautiful, and they sneeze, and oh, she has the cutest sneeze. She has the cutest sneeze. Oh, just want to hug her. Oh my gosh, that's before marriage, right? 1 year into marriage, you like, she sneezes, whatever she does, you know, that's noise, and you still love. It's all love. And so, baby, you okay? Let me get a blanket for you. Let me get the medicine, some cough drops, some syrup, you know, some formula, something. Baby, let's wrap you up. I'm going to get my baby. You don't feel good. Oh, my girl. Oh, my girl. That's after the first year. Flash forward to 5 years ahead. She sneezes, and you're watching a game. And she sneezes again. And you're like, are you going to do something about that sneeze? Years and three kids later, she sneezes, and you're like, dang, girl, don't be spreading your nasty germs up in here on me, girl. Sure, I gotta go to work tomorrow. I got a hard day. I can't be afford to get sick on the job. You know the man's on my case as it is. Don't be sneezing. Go to the doctor or something, and take your kids with you. Your kids that you made by yourself, take them with you. Game. A deterioration in our love and affection, amore, is no longer in the air. I think the same thing happens in the body of Christ, doesn't it? We welcome you to Hope's House, to the church. The doors of the church are open for membership, and we're glad to have you in the house, and not just Hope's House, any church. Everybody's on best behavior. you get a cup of water, a gift, or a CD or something, or a parting gift, and people welcome you to shake the pastor's hand or have a reception or do something, and everybody's like, oh, praise God, welcome, you're new, oh, God bless you, yes, good to see you, God bless you. And then after a few weeks, your sister so-and-so, or brother this and that, you know, brother this and that came in here asking for some money again. Your sister so-and-so been spreading gossip again. I'm going to give her a piece of my mind. I ain't got much, but I'm going to give her what I got, okay? And after a few years, how long you been on the praise team in the choir? You can't show up on time. You know every Easter we sing a song. After a few years, the honeymoon is over, but we're still members of the same body. Here's the deal. You were a recruit before. You ever seen people get recruited for football or basketball? Don't you see all, if you know folks who've been recruited, all the love, all the scouts are coming out saying, come join our team. This is the best school. You're going to play. You're going to be a star. You're going to make us great. And the recruiting process is amazing because all this love, all this attention is placed on you, and you feel like you're the most special person in the world. I can't say I've experienced it myself, but damn, my wife recruited me. She said, you all that, I want to marry you. Oh, my God, I need you in my life. Woo, 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 woo. She, right? I was like, I couldn't help but say yes. I just, and it's still that way today. She's still like, yeah, baby. Because she's unstuck, you know. So, but in the church sometime, we do a great job of recruiting people, tell them how God loves them, how much we love them, how blessed they are, how they have a future and a hope and all these wonderful things. And after a few years, the thrill is gone, right? The thrill is gone, and they become just brother this and that, or sister so-and-so, or the one that always causes problems, always calls the office and wants to bug Miss Iris, or the one who always is coming there and looking for something. It's like, okay, and then we kind of like get kind of cool toward our brothers and sisters. So I want to encourage you that we can maintain a high level of ministry one to another if we have the right perspective. And I ask the question, is your response fit for a king? And so I want to establish the fact that, first of all, you are royalty and you are special. Your boo, who was a royal queen, my Nigerian queen, I'm going to marry. You know, all these different things we talk about, my queen, right? Before we get married. And she's still your queen 20 years in the marriage. And as she loses her shape, he's still your king. As he gets his beer belly gets bigger, right? You are my king. You are. I'm sorry. Okay, so, but see, we got to keep things in perspective in God, because God doesn't change his opinion upon you after the honeymoon is over, right? He doesn't change his opinion of you after the honeymoon period is over. Once he brings you into God, he still sees you highly, and he exalts you and honors you, okay? So let me give you a couple passages. 1 Peter 2:9 says, but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. God says you are royalty. Come on, tell somebody next to you, you look royal to me today. Amen. He goes on and says in Revelations 1:6, and has made us, y'all royal, okay? Revelations 1:6, and he has made us kings and priests to his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever. So there's a place in God where he says, you are royal, you are respected, you are revered, you're important to me, and I exalt you into a place, in spite of yourself, to a place of royalty. That's how I see you. But our challenge is, as believers, sometimes we see other things, don't we? We don't see the royalty shining through all the time, do we? We see other things, and we respond to what we see. So the question, once again, is your response fit for a king? Because you are a king. Jeffrey, you are a king. King is among the king of somewhere. You're king of something. But in God's sight, you are royalty. Can I give you a pastoral transparency example of how I ministered effectively to a waiter at a restaurant? I believe, and my wife believes, that some of the people that can do the least for you, you should show the most honor. Amen? So, like, you know, I've seen people with the valet and waiters and waitresses and hostesses just treat them like dirt sometimes. But if we can honor those who can do nothing for you, as opposed to your favorite starer who comes in and still won't do nothing for you. You're like, oh, it's so-and-so, oh my God, you're so great, you're so wonderful, and they ain't doing nothing for you either, most cases. But if we can honor those who are lower than us as we perceive them lower, then we are in a good place. And I want to share an example how I was able to bring honor to the name of Jesus Christ in a situation. So we're at this restaurant every year. Pastor Dre invites the office staff to go out for lunch. And I usually can't make it. It's around Christmas time. I'm usually working. So, but every now and again, I've been able to make it and enjoy lunch with the pastoral team, the staff that works here. And I want to give it for the staff because you guys work hard behind the scenes to make things happen. So Miss Tiffany and Tony in his absence used to be there, and Pastor Randall, they do so much stuff. And I don't see most of the church stuff that happens. Things happen without me knowing because they make it happen in an amazing way. Our media staff, those folks. And so we want to honor them and say thank you for a job well done, keeping things together so we don't go crazy. And so we take them out to lunch. I was there this past year, went to Malibu, woo. And so had lunch, had a great time. And there are a couple of folks that have working on staff who are not part of this church. They are interns, is that the word? They're interns, so they're part-time, and they just help in the office, books and records and things like that, and you guys never see them. And I hardly ever see them either, but I saw them on this wonderful day at lunch. And as a result of having time together and having a great lunch, time came to order dessert. And as a result of dessert being, menus being passed out, I saw something. I like kind of fruity type things as opposed to chocolate things. So for future reference, if you want to bless me, don't give me chocolate, give me fruit, okay? So I saw this pineapple upside down cake. The picture was amazing. I'm like, oh my God, I gotta have that thing. But I was kind of full, so I wanted to take it home with me, right? And this is kind of like Pastor Dre's story about the cookie biscuits. Remember the guy on the plane who thought the cookies were his? He thought he was right, but he was wrong. And this is one of those situations where I thought I was right, but I was wrong. Even though at the time, I thought I was right. In fact, I knew I was right 100%. I would have told anybody I was right at the time, but I was wrong. Got that? You guys have those moments where you just know you're right because you're always right. And even if people tell you that you're wrong, you say, I'm right. I'm right to tell you that you're wrong, to think I'm wrong when I'm right. You're that person, right? Okay, so I had this moment. And so I brought the dessert menu. People ordered dessert. I'm like, I want mine to go so I can eat some here and eat some later. And so I meant to articulate to the person who was waiting on the table that I want some in a to-go container because I'm not gonna eat the whole thing and I hate to waste it and I wanna take it home with me. That was my intention. Thought I was right. What I said was, I'll take mine to go. And my experience has been that people typically, if you're still there lingering at the table, they'll bring your to-go items to the table to you, right? Okay, that happens. And sometimes they may, this guy, he left it at the kiosk at the front. And I'm seeing everybody eat their dessert, and mine isn't coming. And Tony's looking real good. I'm gonna reach over and get some of Tony's. I'm like, nah. And they said, PC, you want some? Nah, mine is coming. And so this story is building up inside of me, how I'm getting disrespected, all these things by this waiter who I don't know at this restaurant, and everybody else is enjoying their savory, this juicy, caramelized, you know, dripping, drooling dessert they have. And I'm like, okay, mine is coming. Guy passes by a couple of times. I'm thinking, no response. So I finally ask, where's my dessert? He said, it's ready. I'm like, it's ready. He said, it's coming or it's ready. I'm like, okay, so I'm going to be patient. Because patience is a virtue, the Bible says, right? So I'm going to be patient, and it hasn't come yet. And so ask again, and he said, it's ready at the front desk. I'm like, and I don't know what demonic manifestation came out of me at the time, but according to the people around me, Iris was there, Pastor Dre was there, Tony was there, and the interns who I don't know, who don't know me, were there. They saw this. I want it right now. I said something because all the folks at the table were like, woo, Mufasa. And so, man, what did I say? I just want my dessert. That's all I want. I just want my dessert. And they were like, Pastor Chuck, my goodness. The waiter was like, woo. And so I'm like, what? And in my mind, I had this story built up, but he's dissing me. He didn't bring it on time. I told him I wanted it here. He took what I said literally. I wanted to go. So he made it to go and put it at the front table. So when I go, I can take it on my way out. which made sense to him, didn't make sense to me. Because in my mind, I was right telling him I wanted to go, but I mean I wanted here so I could eat it and take it. So, needless to say, I wasn't very much of a witness to that gentleman today, and he'll never come to Hope's house because the pastor. So if you see this young man, please minister to him. Don't invite him here because he won't listen to a word I said because I spoke words to him harshly and he probably stirred up some strife. But I did apologize to the guy after the whole team, like, Pastor, shut up! Oh my goodness! Pastor Jerry said, I see that all the time, man. But it's one of those examples of how you don't know and you think certain things, you think you're right, and you bring words that tear people down. And sometimes you don't plan to, but it's just because you have an agenda, or you're impatient, or you're angry, or hangry sometimes, right? Hungry and angry at the same time, right? Or different things like that. And so I want to give you an example in the Bible of a person who brought harsh words. And thank you, staff, for lovingly bringing back to a place of restoration in my pastoralship, because I was really feeling bad that day, like, dang. And the interns who quit on the spot, they're just like, we never working there again. So a story about David, Nabal, and Abigail in 1 Samuel 25 gives a wonderful contrast of how our response to people can stir up wrath or anger or strife or bring forth life. And this is 1 Samuel 25. I'm going to read it from the Message version of the Bible because it reads better. It's more interesting. But the backdrop is this. David has already left Saul's kingdom because Saul is insanely jealous about David's anointing and the grace upon his life, and he feels like David's a threat to the kingdom. So David is chasing Saul across the countryside. And in the previous chapter, it so happens that David was in a cave, and Saul went in the cave to relieve himself, and David was able to sneak up on Saul and tear apart part of his garment, and but not kill him as his men said, you should kill Saul. This is a chance. God has placed you in his hands and placed him in your hands, and he is now vulnerable to you to kill him. And the problem that you have about running across the countryside from this man who's crazy, insanely jealous of you, you can be solved right now if you just take his life right now. David doesn't do it. David says, I will not touch God's anointed, right? Remember that? He has such a high honor for the position and for the king, Saul, and he says, I'm not going to be the one to take his life. He can chase me all day, all night, but before God and my honor for God and my honor for the king and the kingdom of Israel, I will not take his life, even though I have a chance. Now, no, none of us ever do that because sometimes we take people's lives when we have the chance. Somebody dogged you and dissed you. You're looking for that chance to just get a little, not major payback, just enough to let them know, right? You're not trying to really hurt them. You just want to make them understand, next time you mess with me, you know, the whole circle snap, right? Next time you mess with me, you got issues, right? We don't want to really hurt them or harm them or take something from them. We want to let them know and put the record straight so in their mind they don't ever diss you again. And sometimes we have a chance to repay, but we understand the Bible says, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. We say it, we don't believe it though. We say it, we don't believe it. David had a chance to take vengeance himself, but he believed vengeance was God's, and he let Saul go. Fast forward to chapter 25, David, after the prophet Samuel dies, he's still running from Saul. He's in this open area where there's sheep shearing going on by Nabal's servants. They're shearing sheep, and David's actually protecting them from marauders, from bandits, from raiders who would steal their stuff, just because he's David and he has 600 men with him in the field, and Nabal benefits by David's presence as a protective force against all the potential folks who would steal his sheep. So David makes a request to Nabal, a very polite request, and says, look, hey, we're out in the field all this time, I'm running from Saul, this is not fun, it's not enjoyable, and we just want some provision from a man, help us out on our way, ask your master if he can hook us up. And Nabal's response is very, very crazy. Let me read it to you. Verse 9. It says, David's young men went and delivered the message of the word for word to Nabal. Nabal tore into them, who is David? Who is the son of Jesse? This country is full of runaway servants these days. Don't you think I'm going to take good bread and wine and meat freshly butchered for my sheep shearers and give it to men I've never laid eyes on? Who knows where they've come from? David's men got out of there and went back to told David what he had said. David said, strap on your swords. They all strapped on their swords, David and his men, and set out 400 of them, and 200 stayed behind to guard the camp. So David, as a result of hearing Nabal's response, says, okay, it's going to be like that? You know, the male ego rises up. Nabal, I know you're rich. I know you have lots of sheep. You got it going on. This is your territory. I've been protecting your man out here all this time, but you're going to give me that kind of response? I just simply ask you for food and drink and provision, and you act a fool? Because Nabal looked at David as a fugitive, as a refugee, as a rebel, as one who left his master. He's like, they're a dime a dozen. I ain't giving him nothing. Very harsh answer, which spurned some wrath in David. So Nabal means foolish, impious, abandoned, and wicked. Nabal sees David as a rogue servant, a rebel, an outcast, a taker, a nuisance, an unworthy person, someone beneath him, and a potential drain on his resources. Nabal spoke to David according to his low view of who David was. Now, mind you, David was already anointed king by Samuel. He was not in the king position yet, but he was anointed king, and he had been in the palace, being the right hand to Saul. So David, even without his position, had some history that spoke of royalty. Amen? And God's hand was on his life. Nabal didn't see it that way. Nabal looked at him after the flesh as a threat, as an enemy, and said, nah, I'm giving you nothing. Nabal responded in pride, which caused contention. Remember that? Pastor Dre said what? Wherever you see contention, what's there? Pride. Pride. Nabal's words spoke to his servants, spoke to and stirred up David's flesh, his ego, his male pride. And listen, don't get it twisted. David was from back in the hood. David knew how to fight. David was a great worshiper, but he was a great warrior, right? David knew how to throw it down, right? So it's on and cracking. So David says, strap up, shoo, we going in, okay? So in the meantime, verse 17, Abigail has a very different response. Meanwhile, one of the young shepherds, verse 14, told Abigail, Nabal's wife, what had happened. David sent messengers from the back country to salute our master, but he tore into them with insults. Yet these men treated us very well. They took nothing from us and did not take advantage of us all the time we were in the fields. They formed a wall around us, protecting us day and night all the time we were out there tending to the sheep. Do something quickly because big trouble is ahead for our master and all of us. Nobody can talk to him. He's impossible, a real brute, speaking of Nabal. Have you ever done something for someone, go out of your way, and get a response that doesn't measure up to what you, are you? Can you tell me your story, please? Because you, she said, yeah, honey, I got about two. I think mothers are in a particular position where you go out of your way for your kids over and over again, whether you're small kids or grown kids, and sometimes just a thank you would set you right. They'd be like, they go about their business. Act as if you just, you know, you slaved, cooked all night, drove across the country to pick them up at the field trip or got them out of jail, right? They overdosed on something, they got drunk, and they were sloppy drunk, and you gave them coffee and nursed them back there. I mean, kids are the epitome of the potential for unthankfulness for all that mothers do. David did an amazing thing. He was in the field running for his life, but he had time and capacity to protect a man who's a fool, who he didn't know. He protected his sheep and his property. I would expect at least a gift card, Subway sandwich, $5, any something. Send me to the massage place. But he says no, even though David served as protection, free protection, by the way, by some very skilled fighters for Nabal. Nabal treats him harshly. So the servants have seen this before, and they said, we're going to tell the wife, because the wife is wise, she's beautiful, she's aware, she's sensitive, and she has a heart that is compassionate toward people. And they said, let's talk to, sometimes you can't talk to the husband. You got to talk to the wife. I know, I'm just saying, sometimes you can get a message to or through a wife because she has a different filter that she lives in. And guys, sometimes we can be kind of have blinders on, we compartmentalize things, and we'll miss it. Then when the wife knows, she tells her, oh, really? Oh, is that what's going on? My wife kicks me on the table on a regular basis, like, they meant this. They want you to say thank you. I'm like, oh, thank you. Wives are good for that kind of stuff, man. Wives have different filters. They have different sensitivities, different perceptions. Now, this is the extreme case. Nabal is just a straight fool, and he needs help. He needs intervention. So, verse 18 says, Abigail flew into action. She didn't sit about it. She didn't go on the phone. She got into action. It says she took 200 loaves of bread, 2 skins of wine, 5 sheep dressed out and ready for cooking, 1 bushel of roasted grain, 100 raisin cakes, 200 fig cakes. Sounds like my wife, huh? Sounds like Pastor Dre. And she had it all loaded up on some donkeys. Then she said to her young servants, go ahead and pave the way for me. I'm right behind you. But she said nothing to her husband. She did the Pastor Dre number. Mac and cheese, greens, chicken, fried chicken, baked chicken, a ham, cornbread, all the fixings, and peach cobbler on top of that, and said, okay, take it to David. Y'all don't know Pastor Dre like that? Oh, back in the day? Okay. That's how she does. She over-delivers. If I say 2 people are coming over for dinner, she'll make so much stuff that we can eat for weeks. I said, but they're vegetarians. They don't eat meat. 5 chickens, 2 hams. But it's a spirit of generosity. Nabal didn't have it. Abigail had it, right? So she does all these things. So here's Abigail. Abigail means my father's joy or source of joy. She sees and responds to David as a king, even though he's still running from Saul and not a king yet. Her response to him reflected her respect, deference, favor, and kindness. She cleaned up her husband's mess. I know there's no men in this house who had to have your wife clean up your mess, but it does happen from time to time that the woman has to come behind and say what he really meant to say was such and such. It's just me, huh? It's just me? I'm the only one? I have such a wise wife. Sometimes she recognizes what I meant to say doesn't come out right. She says, what Pastor Chuck meant to say was, he loves you. You know, he punched you in the arm or hit you. You know, I mean, just things like that. And sometimes wives have the ability to say, you know what? Let me paint the picture a little differently so you can understand. Now, this girl, Abigail, had some work to do, right? She had a big job. So she does these things. She meets David. She goes and comes out. She acts, as Pastor Dre mentioned, she acts as a peacemaker, doesn't she? She acts as a peacemaker. On behalf of her foolish husband, she acts as a reconciler of relationships, and I heard that we have a ministry of reconciliation. Is that what you said? Oh, so we should act the same way like Abigail did, okay? She acted as a protector and preserver of her husband and her household. And she acted as an intercessor on behalf of her household. Like many women, mothers today, you have the gift of fix-it. Y'all got the gift to fix it? You ever have a mother who has the gift to fix it? You know, cousin Pookie get in jail and you go down to Bell's Mosman and fix it. You know, your kid's cutting up in school and in trouble with the principal again and you go down there to fix it. Your kid got into a fender bender with the car that they don't own and that's behind in payments, but you find money to fix it. You know, wives, you do that stuff, you know. You're always fixing stuff for other people. And it's almost epidemic in some families where you're fixing, 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 and people aren't thankful, and you feel like there's nothing left for me. But Abigail said, I'm going to fix this thing, because this was a matter of life and death. Nabal's made some stupid moves before. He's made some folks mad. He's offended people. But I got to fix this thing, because it's about life now. You got to get killed up in here, okay? So she does all this and goes on and says, She goes to verse 22. I'm going to finish this story, and I'm going to give you a couple points. You go home, have your dinner, have your brunch, stand out in front of Claim Jumper for 2 hours, and enjoy yourself, okay? All right. Verse 20. As she was riding her donkey, descending into a ravine, David and his men were descending from the other end, so they met there on the road. David had just said, that sure was a waste, guarding everything this man had out in the wild so that nothing he had was lost, and now he rewards me with insults. A real slap in the face. May God do his worst to me if Nabal and every cur in his misbegotten brood aren't dead meat by morning. I'm like, dang, I think David's upset. As soon as Abigail saw David, she got off her donkey, fell on her knees at his feet, her face to the ground in homage, saying, my master, let me take the blame. Whoa, for real? Oh, hold up, no, my husband's stupid. Stand back. She said, let me take the blame. What kind of crazy love is that? Is it love? Is he crazy? She's almost as good as dead. She says, let me take the blame. She stands in place of the bullet, in the way of the bullet for her husband. I think she is the definition of ride or die. I think she's that chick, okay? She says, ride or die chick, okay? All right, so she says, let me take the blame. Let me speak to you. Listen to what I have to say. Don't dwell on what that brute Nabal said. He asked out the meaning of his name. Nabal, fool, and foolishness oozes from him. I'm like, the wife can tell you. Women have a way with words, don't they? My Lord. So verse 25, I wasn't there when the young man my master sent arrived. I didn't see them. And now my master, as God lives and as you live, God has kept you from this avenging murder. And may your enemies, all who seek my master's harm, end up like Nabal. Now take this gift that I, your servant girl, has brought to my master and give it to the young men who follow in the steps of my master. Forgive my presumption, but God is at work in my master, developing a rule solid and dependable. My master fights God's battles. As long as you live, no evil will stick to you. If anyone stands in your way, know this, your God-honored life is tightly bound in the bundle of God's protected life. But the lives of your enemies will be hurled aside as a stone is thrown from a sling. When God completes all the goodness he has promised my master and sets you up as prince over Israel, my master will not have this dead weight in his heart, the guilt of an avenging murderer. And when God has worked things for good for my master, remember me. Okay, I think Abigail is spitting some mad game right now, okay? She is talking to David like, dang, for real, like? So she tells David a few things. One, don't do this thing. She says, I'll take the bullet, but first of all, listen to me. I'll take the blame. That's called intercession, isn't it? Someone stands in the gap on your behalf, even though you did all kind of manner of stupid stuff and you deserve the bullet. She says, I will intercede for you. She's an advocate. Ever go to court? You have a lawyer? They're supposed to be your advocate. They're supposed to speak on your behalf to the judge. She does that to David on behalf of Nabal, once again, who's a fool, who deserves everything that's coming to him, but she says, hold up. Let me advocate on behalf of my husband, who, by the way, didn't even know. Have you ever been in a situation where you're cutting up and you know you have a grandmother praying for you or a mother praying for you and death almost visited your doorstep, but because somebody was praying for you and you didn't even know it, and you're here today worshiping in the house of God because somebody advocated on your behalf? That's all of us. You don't know how close you've come to danger. And they didn't tell you the report. There's no video evidence, but the angels in heaven know that the car was about to hit you, but turned down 58th Street instead of 56th Street, where it would have got you. I look at those drive-bys on the freeway and the helicopter view. I'm like, what if you was just right around the corner and, you know, it happens. So God averts this danger from coming to Nabal because his wife interceded for him. But I'm going to tell you, some of your mamas have prayed for y'all, and that's why you're here today. Some of your grandmothers, your aunties have prayed for y'all while you're out there smoking the stuff, while you're out there rolling dice, while you're out there getting drunk and getting high. Somebody's praying for you, and maybe you didn't get saved right then, but in the fullness of time, God brought you out. Amen? Amen. So, they have this situation. I love what Abigail does. Abigail is not trying to preserve her life or get over. Now, if it was me, if I was ready, hey, David, I got a fool for a husband. I'm available. I'm about to serve divorce papers today. Oh, wait, hold up. People get divorced for a whole lot less these days. Well, we just seem like we've grown apart. We're incompatible now after 20 years of marriage. That's a reason for divorce? Well, you know, me and my husband, we don't see eye to eye. We have different philosophies on raising kids, so I can't live with him no more. What? I know what the Bible says. The Bible gives a couple of reasons for divorce. One's infidelity, right? Ain't no other reasons, huh? And people get divorced and break up for all kinds of reasons. Abigail is ride or die, and she's interceding for a man who is hopelessly a fool. And she is not trying to get over for herself. She's trying to preserve her household. And let me read you the rest, because it's amazing what she does and why she does it. So here she does. She doesn't flirt with David. She said, David, I'm still young. I still got a few years left. And I don't have no kids, so you know. She didn't say, David, call me. She didn't flirt with him. She didn't show him her assets. She didn't try to impress him with how great she was, or how fine she was, or how great she was in bed. Oh, okay. You know, in this life, in some cases, some women think the way to hold a man's attention is to show him all you got. You want to make an impression on him for fleshly reasons, when God has called you to impress upon him the godliness that he's called to. And see, what happens is sometimes women in this competition for the man or for something, you start the dolphin doing tricks. What's the coming to America? Right? Coming, whoop, 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 whoop. Coming to America, right? You do tricks to get the attention. This chick wasn't about playing tricks. She's trying to preserve life. And so she says, because life is important to me, my household is important to me, and my husband, who is a dishonorable guy, is important to me. Listen to me. I think we throw in the towel way too quick on marriages these days. I'm not saying be in abusive situations. I'm not saying be in a situation where you're in danger or harm. I'm saying we don't work as hard as we do to stay married as we do to get married. We pull out all the stops to get married. Flowers, candy, great drive-in movies. Oh, drive-ins, you got me on the drive-ins. movies, tickets, concert. You go to concerts, it costs all this money. And then when it's time to work in the marriage, we say, you know what, this ain't working out. I'm tired, this is too much work. What God has joined together, let no man put asunder. That's not just for the parents and the family, that's for you too. Right? It's for those in the marriage, okay? So she's working it out. She does not flirt with David. She does not minister to his flesh or his ego or his pride. She ministers to his spirit and speaks life to him and speaks to his values, his character, and his purpose. Ladies, the way to keep a man is to speak to his values, his character, and his purpose. Any sister can speak to his flesh. Turn on a music video. You see your sister speaking to his flesh all the time. Why are you different? You're not different. And it's unfortunate that some of our young ladies have bought into the lie that you have to have sex with a man to keep a man's attention. No, because sister so-and-so probably can do it better than you. And you'll never know, because he won't tell you as he's doing the butterfly from house to house, from plant to plant, from flower to flower. You think your stuff is special. Your stuff ain't that special. You are not that special physically. You can be cute, you can be fine, and you can get his attention, but to make it last, you can't just minister on a surface, natural, fleshly level, because he's more than that. I know he thinks he's all that, and he's all, you know, I think, and here's the deal. We got egos, and you can speak to his ego, or you can speak to his spirit. And if you win somebody by speaking to their ego, you have to keep on feeding the ego. If you get them by ministering to their flesh, you have to keep on ministering to their flesh. But if you can minister to their spirit, that lasts a lifetime, because the word of God endures forever, amen? Okay, so. So you can choose to impress a man for a moment or impress upon him a legacy for a lifetime. Amen? And so, still, here's what happens. Here's what happens after it's all over. David's response. We mentioned that there's a response to these words. Verse 32 says, "And David said, 'Blessed be God, the God of Israel. He sent you to meet me, and blessed be your good sense. Bless you for keeping me from murder and taking charge and looking out for me. A close call. As God lives, the God of Israel who kept me from hurting you, if you had not come as quickly as you did, stopping me in my tracks, by morning there would not have been, there'd been nothing left of Nabal but dead meat." close. Then David accepted the gift. She brought him and said, return home in peace. I've heard what you said, and I'll do what you've asked. So, moral to the story, because you guys got to eat. Claim jumper's waiting. The reservations are waiting. Abigail does an amazing job of standing back from the situation, not trying to preserve her own neck in a selfish way, but preserve something more. She preserved two things. She preserved her household, so the anger of David was averted and there was no dead meat in the house, amen? So she preserved life and she also preserved David's legacy. What do I mean? David had honored Saul by not killing Saul, but he was gonna kill Nabal. He honored the man who was anointed, but Nabal wasn't anointed. He's like, I could kill you and I'll feel good about that. But God says, no, to take someone's life in a rash manner is wrong either way. And sometimes we make these judgments, well, I'm going to respect the pastor, but I'm going to disrespect sister so-and-so. And God is saying to David, both are wrong. You got it right with Saul. Don't kill him because he's anointed. He's chosen by God, and he's in the position as king. But the regular person, the valet, the shoeshine boy, the car wash person, the person we don't think is all that, we tend to kill them in different ways or compromise them. And so God, this thing is coming off my ear. So God has David kept from doing a rash act that would have impaired his legacy. Because the next chapter, Saul is still chasing him, and David again has a chance to kill him, but doesn't kill Saul. So can you imagine David honored God before Nabal, honored God after Nabal, but he had a chance to dishonor God by killing Nabal, and Abigail stopped it from happening. I want to encourage you as we close to not just speak to the circumstances, but speak to the king. What Abigail did, she spoke to the king inside of David. She didn't speak to the guy with the ego. She didn't speak to the warrior. She didn't speak to the sexual, virile man. She spoke to the king inside of David and brought out the purpose of David so he could recognize, oh my goodness, I am called to serve God. I am called to live in such a way that honors God. I can't, you stop me from doing a rash act that I wouldn't have done in my right mind. But sometimes we lose our mind, don't we? And want to do something rash and something stupid, and we'll just pay for it later, won't we? We joke about, you know, just take me to jail now because I'm about to kill. Right? Your kids act up for the last time. Look, call the coroner and child services, and we all go in together, okay, right? But David had a chance to dishonor God, and Abigail says, look, there's a king inside of you that God wants to raise up to be an established place for the Israel to live off of and to prosper by, and you cannot compromise that over a fool. Sometimes we tend to compromise our godly heritage because of a fool who provoked us. Who's the person who pushed your buttons and you said, you know what, just this time, I'm gonna lose my Christianity. Yeah, I wasn't saved all my life, and I'm gonna let you know how unsaved I was, right? And we let someone pull us down to their level. David's the king, a man after God's own heart, and Nabal, a fool, has almost brought David down to his level to respond like a fool with a fool. What do you get when you engage a fool? Foolishness. You get a reality show, drama, right? But you're better than that. And this is what she's saying. She said, David, you're better than that. You're bigger than that. Take the high road. Forgive this foolishness. Receive my gift. Don't kill the whole household and don't kill me. And David says, you came in the nick of time. You came in the nick of time. Can I let you know that the words in your mouth can either cause destruction or cause someone to come into the right mind and not do something stupid? I want to encourage you, even if there are people in your life who challenge you, don't speak to them. You should stop doing drugs, and you should stop drinking, and every time you come over, and I will never let you in the house again. Speak to the king inside that person, because there's somebody in there that God wants to come out who is full of purpose, full of promise, full of ability, full of creativity that God wants to use for himself. And we jump in the same bag with them and be foolish with them, and we go tit for tat, all these different things, and we're trading bars with a fool. When God's giving you words of life and God's giving you ability to speak prophetically into their lives, and here you are threatening, cussing, fussing, dozens, all that stuff, right? Doing stupid stuff that's beneath you. And how about with your brothers and sisters in the Lord? How about those that you fellowship with, those in the body of Christ? God is saying, don't speak to them according to the flesh. I know they're messing up. I know they took your last food out the refrigerator. I know they threw your stuff away. But speak to the King inside them. So when my wife confronted me about throwing things away, what she was saying, even though I didn't receive it at the time, she said, you're better than that. You know how to be respectful and ask. You know how to give your kids a sense of importance by respecting them. She spoke to the King in me. And listen, I didn't like it at the time. But as I thought about it, I said, yeah, I should give my kids respect because I'm modeling what respect looks like with her. I got to model respect to them also. And value of their possessions, value of their opinions. Speak to the King in others. Sometimes it's hard to see past the veneer of their bluster, their prideful intentions, their noisy, boastful activities, but speak to the King. How do you do that? You do it by prayer. From a distance. You know someone who's in a hard situation, they're always a pain, they're always challenging, they're always just resistant. Speak to the King in prayer. Say in the name of Jesus Christ, I know this person is messing up in school. I know they're spending all the resources, but I declare in the name of Jesus Christ, I'm speaking to the King inside them and declaring that the righteousness of God was going to rise up inside them and they'll see the light and they'll begin to turn things around as they respond to God. Speak that. Speak to the King inside them when you see them in present. Encourage them. Here's a crazy situation. Let's say you know your friend has a penchant for stealing stuff and you say, see, there's a phone. That's a good-looking phone. Shoot. Tell them, you know what? I praise God that we are Christians and we don't steal. Praise the Lord. The Bible says, thou shalt not steal. How about that? Praise God. We ain't going to steal none, are we? No, we speak to the King in them. Give them what David got was a reminder of the promises of God that were for him as opposed to the compulsion to act now in haste. There's people in your lives that don't act like the King that they're called to be. I know I have folks in my lives. And you can fight with them, you can cuss them out, you can out-cuss them maybe, but will they change? Have they changed yet? Have they changed yet? Has all your cussing at them changed them? I know y'all cuss, come on. Has all your cussing changed? Has all your fussing at them changed them? I think it's time for a change of strategy. There's a King inside them that's waiting to get out. And your words can bring them back to that reality if you just speak to the King inside them. When it looks crazy, speak to the King. When they're disrespecting you, speak to the King. When they lied on you, speak to the King. When they treated you like dirt, speak to the King inside them. And you declare in heaven that this is who they are in spite of that. And they'll say, why do you always act like I'm better than I am? Because they are. In God, they are. And you have the sensible insight to recognize that. I'm going to ask you this week to find those challenging situations, especially for you moms who are tired and sick and tired of your kids. Speak to the King inside them. Speak to the King inside them. Words of life, like Abigail did. Amen. Let's close in prayer. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you. We thank you as our counselors are coming. I want to just pray, first of all, for those who may have some challenging situations and challenging relationships in their lives. That you feel like, you know what, I've been putting up with so-and-so's mess for so long, and I'm at the end of my rope. They got to move out. They got to get out. They got to leave. All these different things. But maybe you have some challenging situations, and you want to see a change. All your fussing and fighting hasn't brought any life forth, but God's saying, maybe this is a chance for you to speak to them and speak to the King that's inside them. Anybody have some challenges? We're not going to have them come up. Just wave your hand. Wave your hand. Family challenges, relationship challenges, that you just want God to just jump in. I know you can qualify. Praise God. So I just want to pray for you guys. As your hand is raised, just pray. Father, we thank you and praise you, Lord God, that we don't have to jump in the pit with people, Lord God. We don't have to jump in the mess and the mire and the muck with them, Lord God. But we can speak to the things that are on the inside of them, Lord God, the things that you have made alive and birthed in them, the things that you created, Lord God, to bring forth glory to your name. We speak those lives, those kids who are addicted with drugs, those kids who are hooked on pornography, those kids who may be fighting in school and dysfunctional, not paying attention to teachers. We speak to the greatness inside of them in Jesus Christ's name. And we declare that by the Spirit of God, they begin to rise up and see things differently and begin to change their behavior because of the grace of God upon them. God, we speak to those relationships, those husbands, those wives who have been ornery, obstinate, non-compliant, resistant, whatever, even if it's a custody battle, Lord God, we speak to the King inside of deadbeat dads in Jesus Christ's name. We speak to the King inside of bitter women, Lord, who've been hurt by relationship. We speak to the Queen inside them, Lord God, and say, arise, woman of God, rise up and be who you are in God. And in spite of the hurts and the pains, there's a God inside of you who wants to shine forth as a light in a dark place. God, we speak to the King and the Queen in those relationships in Jesus Christ's name. Those who are just tired of each other, Lord God, we speak to the King and Queen inside them, Lord God, and say there's a God who's full of life and full of vitality and full of a blessing and anointing inside them. Cause that person to rise up. The one they first met when they first got married, Lord God, full of life, full of vision, full of hope, full of purpose, Lord God. We speak to that person, Lord God, and say, rise up in Jesus Christ's name. Holy Spirit, grab hold of that person and cause them to stand up in the power of the Spirit in Jesus Christ's name. For those relationships on the job, Lord God, where there's disrespect, Lord God, and lack of recognition, Lord God, we speak to the bosses, the supervisors, Lord God, the co-workers in Jesus Christ's name. We speak to the King inside of them, Lord God, and cause them, Lord God, to operate honorably, Lord God, operate in integrity in Jesus Christ. Operate, Lord God, with sensitivity to our needs and listen and hear as opposed to just dictate orders, Lord God. We thank you for changing the atmosphere on the job because they have an experience and encounter with you. And those who are Christians who don't act like Christians on the job, we speak to the King and Queen inside them, Lord God, and say, Spirit of God, stir them up to righteousness. Stir them up to life. Stir them up to be a blessing in Jesus Christ's name. Cause their words to be life-filled and Spirit-filled and power-filled in Jesus Christ's name. We speak to the Kings in Jesus Christ's name. Father, for our elders, Lord God, who maybe are cantankerous or cranky or upset about how their life turned out, we speak to those, Lord God. Even as we go to Casitas Care today, later, we speak to the Kings and Queens who are infirmed and rehabilitating, Lord God, or retiring, Lord God. We pray and speak to their hearts, Lord God. Invigorate them by your Spirit, Lord God. Invigorate them by your Spirit, Lord God. Give us something to give them that they can't get anywhere else but from you, Father. In Jesus Christ's name, give us grace to speak to the King inside each person. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. While your heads are bowed, while your eyes are closed, I know some people here may be here to church for the first time. You may not be saved. You may not know Jesus Christ, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, for your own personal salvation. We want to invite you to come to know Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord. While your heads are bowed and eyes are closed, if you are here and you're not saved, you don't know if you go to heaven, if you left this place and died today, you don't know. If tragedy visits your house and your life is taken, if you're not sure if you go to heaven, we want you to come down now and pray with one of our counselors and ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart and save you from your sin, save you from the punishment of sin and the penalty of sin. If you want to be saved, come on down right now. I know most folks here are believers, but if you are here as a believer and you want to rededicate your life to God, you can do so now. We may have been off track, living a life, living like Nabal, being foolish, being unwise, being hard-hearted, hard-headed, but you want to get back on track. You know you've offended people and you've done things, you've been a taker, but you want to give your life back to God so you can be a blesser in Jesus' name. Come on down. We want to pray with you and pray for you if you need prayer to rededicate your life. Third invitation is this. If you are a believer and you need to walk in power, the Bible says he'll give you power after the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you'll be witnesses unto me. If you want prayer for power as a witness of Jesus Christ, you want to be more effective as a believer, not just go with the flow, but have an impact on the lives around you. You want to be filled with the Spirit of God. We'd like to pray with you and pray for you. And finally, if you're here and you want to join this church, maybe you're bouncing from church to church, this may be your first time or your 10th time, but you want to join Hope's House today, we want to invite you to be a part of this family, this fellowship. God is doing great things here, and he wants to do great things to you. So our sister Nora is on the side with her head up, hands up over there. She'll give you a little information about how you can join the church and be a part of this family and we definitely welcome you. And we're not recruiting you, but we want to enjoy fellowship with you, amen? So if you want to join the church or respond to any of those invitations, please come down. Or if you just need prayer this day, you just need prayer for anything in life, just please come down. Don't miss the moment that God has before you. Amen? Amen. If you need prayer, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord. Come on down, baby. It's okay. Praise God.
If I can't hear from you,
hallelujah.
Then I'll know.
As you're praying, as you're praying, let's just worship God. We're going to prepare to honor God with our tithes and our offerings at this time. Ask Him to speak to your heart about how you should speak to the King this week. But as you're preparing to give at this time, ask God to speak to your heart about how you should give today. Speak to my heart, God. How can I honor you? How can I bring glory to your name by giving today? As Pastor Dre's mentioned in the last few weeks, most of us are grown folks and we have our own money, our own resources, and God has blessed us tremendously. We remember the days back when Uncle so-and-so or Grandma gave us a dollar or two to put in an offering plate. Those days are over. But God is asking us to be responsible givers, to say, Lord, I recognize your goodness in my life. I recognize all you've done for me. And as a response to you, I want to give unto you and honor you and build your kingdom. And so as you give today, do so with a kingdom mindset. As you give today, give so with a thankful heart. As you give today, give so recognizing that God will do in you and through you things you can't do by yourself as you give today to bless the house. If you look on the screen behind me, there's different ways you can give. You can give by text, give by online giving. You can give it to the kiosk outside. You can do the traditional way and put a $1,000 check or $1,000 cash in the envelope. It's fine too. We'll even take $10,000. We'll take $50,000 if you want to give it. Praise God. We are open to all denominations. But by all means, give unto the Lord a response to Him. How do you respond to a king for all he's done for you? How do you respond to someone who's blessed you? You say thank you. You say thank you. And we want to say a profuse thank you to God for all He's done for us as we give. Amen? Praise the Lord. I'm going to ask you to stand to your feet if you're ready to give. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. If you're ready to give, we're going to stand to our feet. Thank you, Lord God. I want to encourage you just to believe God. Just believe God. Listen, don't just drop it in a bucket. Let's believe God together. He's going to do something with our giving, however large or however small, that God can and will do something as we give today in Jesus' name. Because we're talking about lives. Abigail was concerned about lives. We as believers are called to be like her, reconcilers, intercessors, but to care about lives. So your giving affects lives. Your giving affects lives. And if we don't give, lives will not be affected. I guess they will. We'll be out of a church building. We have nowhere to go. But listen, as we give, we're touching lives outside of our four walls so people can be blessed. Amen? So if you raise your offering with me, raise your offering or your iPhone, your iPad, your mobile device, we're going to give right now. Father, we thank you right now that you have given us such amazing blessing and you call us to be reconcilers and peacemakers. As we give, Lord God, we declare the kingdom of God is able to advance through this particular church body. And we declare that the blessing, the giver, is received by faith in advance, Lord God. So that means that as we sow seed, good seed in the good ground, you give bread for eating and seed for more sowing. We thank you and praise you, Lord God, for increase in our households. We thank you for increase in this church. We thank you that every need's met, Lord God, and we have more than enough to bless others outside the church. Those who come looking for food and those who come looking for clothing and those who come looking for rent to be paid, Lord God, we don't have to turn them away, Lord God, because we're able to give out of our abundance. We ask in Jesus' name that you bless every giver today in an amazing way. Show them how much you love them as they show you how much they love you by giving a response worthy of a king today. In Jesus' name we say amen. Amen. Please follow directions of our ushers. No moving, walking. walk to the that side, that wall, if you're in the center or the left side. And if you're that side, go that wall, the usher will take care of you. Let's worship God as we give, amen.
Opens doors that I cannot see. Jesus will. Jesus will. And who will make all my decisions for me? Jesus will. Jesus will. Sing who.
Miss Marla, that's a blessing. If you'll be seated, we want to finish this off, this time of worship off strong, and acknowledge our mothers. As you go out to the claim jumpers and stand in line for 3 hours, you're so terrible, Pastor Jesus. Joy, we're not going to the Leonard Jr., no claim jumpers. It's a 2-hour wait. Don't go to claim jumpers. But we do want to acknowledge some mothers. First of all, I want to let you know that every mother that's in here, how many mothers do we have in the house? I say, oh, bless God. Oh, bless your hearts. So we have something for each of you. When you go out the door and you look to your left, we call that our Hebrews Cafe. There's a special sweet treat for you that you can take as you press your way out the door. And the ladies have made it look extra special. So please, please stop by there for a special sweet treat for you, sweet mama. But I want to highlight, or we'd like to, the family here, we'd like to highlight a few special mommies, okay? How many of you... I want to know who the oldest mommy is here today. Who is the woman of God on this earth that's been in the ministry of motherhood and you've lived on this earth the longest? This morning we had a mommy, 84. Is anybody here 84? How about that? That mother's home napping now. Because she came out at 8, had a cupcake, and went to bed. Is there a 70-year-old mother here today? There's a 70-year-old mom. Hi, honey. Okay, do we have anybody older than 70? A mother older than 70. Let me see you. Oh, look pretty, ladies. Okay, now how old are you, ladies? Okay, we're going to get you next time, mama. How old are you, ladies? You're 77? Get out of here. What about you, beautiful? 77 twice. Wait. Are you 77 yet? You're right this minute. I think she's the oldest, if my mathematics are right. I would like to bless this lady right here. Amen. Amen. Happy Mother's Day. You've been at this a long time. I'd like to be as gracious as you are today at 77. Bless your heart. Happy Mother's Day, darling. Who's there? Somebody older? Somebody older than 77 over there? No. Okay. All right. Jeepers, Christ. All right, I want to see the newest mommy who has their baby in the building. Hopefully they're back in the baby church. But the newest mommy whose baby is here today with them. The newest mommy. We got lots of babies in here. Who's the newest mom? Yeah, girl. I have something extra for you, too. I have something else that I want to get to you. This is our newest mommy here. How old is your baby girl? 3 months. Oh, she's fresh. That's a fresh one right there. Happy Mother's Day to you, beautiful. And that's your first baby, yes? Oh, my God. Wait a minute. Hold it. Wait a minute. That's fresher? But I have something for you, though. Wait. I have something for you with your name on it, for real, because you and I spoke. I got something for you. How fresh is that baby? She just came out today. She's 3 months today? Today. And when was your baby 3 months? Lord have mercy. Who's 2 months old? Oh, that's baby Gore. That's a man of God nestled down in there, up under the shadow of the Almighty. Okay, hold on, mothers. Hold on. I have something for both of you new mommies. I have something, but Brother Gore, we got something else for you. Amen. That's a young man of God nestled down in there. Bless your heart. But you too, beautiful, see me after church because I have something for you. Amen. Okay, I got one more. I want to see the mother who has the most children in this church house today, with you today, that you drug out the bed. And they're back in children's church, but they're in this building with you. The mother with the most children in this church today that you brought with you. Can I hear a mother that bought two children? How many moms bought two children? All right, I see you. How many mommies bought three children? Okay. Any, where? Over there too. Oh, Lord. How many mommies bought four children? Wait a minute. All right, one, two. Okay, wait, is that one, two? Anybody bought five children up in the church house today? Well, Lord, where? God, Lord, have mercy. Jesus. Five children out to church? No, they're not here. Oh, they're not little. They're grown. Oh, they're grown children. Doesn't matter. They're children in the house of God with their mama on Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day, mother. Happy Mother's Day. Right here. Oh, man. Now, don't forget, ladies, the two of you new mommies, I have something for you. I have something for you. And all the rest of us mothers, make sure you come. That's it for us. Make sure you come by Hebrews Cafe and get your sweet treat, every mother in the house. Amen. We have a special mother.
Hi, I'm Pastor Charles Humphrey, Senior Pastor of Hope's House Christian Ministries.
And I'm Andrea Humphrey, Co-Pastor of Hope's House Christian Ministries.
So we would like to thank you, first of all, for taking time to view our service. Now, if you are ever in the LA area visiting, or if you actually live locally, we'd love to invite you to come out to see what happens here at Hope's House, live and in person.
We have a saying around here, whose house? Hope's house. And we'd like to say, whose house? Your house. So, as my husband said, if you're ever in the area, come and join us.
Now, if you have any prayer requests, or if you just want more information about this particular ministry, you can write us by using an email address. Also, if you'd like to be a supporter of Hope's House, you can do so by using any of the giving options that you see on your screen at this time.
So again, we want to thank you for watching. We believe this is an amazing ministry with God doing really powerful things in the community, transforming lives. So join us every Sunday morning, live streaming here at Hope's House Christian Ministries. Thank you for watching.
God bless.